you've got your Bible this morning, in a moment I'm going to read from Luke chapter 19, first 10 verses of that chapter. In this season of Lent that we're in, as we march toward the cross of Christ, as we prepare ourselves for the agony of Good Friday, but the blessing and the joy of Easter Sunday, as I told you all the last couple of weeks, we're spending this season telling stories of faith. And so I'm grateful to Sharon for sharing her personal story of faith, her testimony. And now in this time up at the pulpit, I'll be sharing the story of a character from Scripture, the story of Zacchaeus from Luke chapter 19. You'll hear it in his voice, just as you heard the story of the leper last week. This is how we'll be doing it for this season. First, though, we read what Luke has to say about Zacchaeus from Luke chapter 19, starting in verse 1. Follow along as I read. The gospel says, he entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, he's gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner. Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I've defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much. Then Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this story. Thank you for this character of Zacchaeus and the way that he can witness to us still today. Thank you for these stories that echo throughout time. And Lord, I pray that this message would honor his story and would honor what you did in his life. It's in Jesus' name that I pray.
Amen.
For I must stay at your house today. Do you hear that? For I must stay at your house today. Must. To this day, that word that Jesus said to me still sticks with me. I must stay at your house today. It really resounded with me in that moment. It still echoes in my ears today, because for my adult life, I really can't think of a time in which anyone had ever really wanted to spend all that much time with me. Nobody wants to hang out with the chief tax collector. Tax collectors aren't a very popular bunch, you understand. The closest to somebody being happy to see me, happy to spend time with me, probably would have been my bosses in the Roman government. Because after all, any time that I was approaching them, it was with bags of cash. It was with the wealth that I had collected for the empire. So usually when I would approach them, there'd be a smile on their face. But the moment that the money had changed hands, they couldn't be rid of me fast enough. They gave me this sort of condescending look, as if wondering what could drive someone like me to take money from my own people and give it to their oppressors. They were happy for the money, to be sure, but didn't want much to do with me. Sometimes, the tax collectors who worked under me, I was the chief tax collector, you remember, I was at the top of the pyramid scheme. Sometimes I would have them over to my house. Sometimes I would invite them into my home and they would sit at my table. But it was an obligatory sort of thing. it was what we might now call a business lunch, a business dinner. No connections were made, no friendships were formed, strictly business. They weren't particularly happy to see me either. And as for my family, my friends, my neighbors, don't make me laugh. They couldn't stand the sight of me. To them, I was first of all a thief. I came by that honestly. I was just doing what all the tax collectors did, you understand. It wasn't anything that was out of the ordinary for people in my profession. But my job was to collect customs for Rome, and the only way for me to make a living was to take a little off the top. It's just the way things were done. I don't mean to excuse it today, but I want you to understand then what my mentality was. It's what a tax collector did. You took enough for Rome, and then you took a little on top for yourself. And I did what everybody else in my profession did. But you can understand why those whose money was being taken wouldn't look too kindly on the tax collector. Certainly not on the chief tax collector. They saw me as a thief. But more so, they saw me as a traitor. For a Jew like me, one of their own, to go work for Rome, to go work for their oppressors, to go work for the empire. This was an act of treason. This was something they couldn't stomach. When they saw me, they saw someone who had turned his back on everything he'd been raised into, had turned his back on his faith, on his people, even on his God. They saw me as a thief. They saw me as a traitor. They saw me as a sinner. They saw me as loathsome, as repulsive, barely even worth acknowledging. No, when I think about the people that I would spend time with, I really don't know that I can name a single person in the world who before that day at the Sycamore would have wanted to spend time with me. My job had given me everything I had. It had given me wealth. I was a rich man. It had given me security. I had the backing of Rome behind me. It had given me power. But it took some things away too. It took away any hope that I could have had for community, for family, for friendship. That was the trade that I had made. I got the money, I got the power, I got the security, but I gave up the people. That was the deal. That was the bargain I had struck as a tax collector. And I wonder if that loss of community, that loss of friendship, of even the hope of friendship, I wonder if that's what drew me to him. If that's what drew me to Jesus. Because I'd heard the whispers. I'd heard the rumors about this rabbi from Nazareth. I heard that along with all of his miracles, along with his incredible teachings, I'd also heard that he was a friend to sinners. That he was willing to eat with the prostitutes, and with the Samaritans, and yes, with the tax collectors. Matter of fact, I had heard that one of his closest friends, one of these 12 who followed him everywhere, one of them had even once been a tax collector. I needed to see for myself. I needed to see if these rumors were true. I needed to see if Jesus had something to offer me. And so, as he passed through Jericho that day, I stepped out into the crowd. I tried not to do this very often, you've got to understand. You can only see people. people hating you so many times before you just decide to withdraw. Before you say enough is enough and become something of a hermit. But on this day, I stepped out amongst the crowd. And let me tell you, when I did, I could feel the disdain on the face of every person there. The naked loathing as they saw that Zacchaeus was among them. And even more so as I tried to push to the front. I couldn't see. I knew Jesus was close by. I could hear the rumblings, but I couldn't see. So I tried to push to the front just to get to where I could catch a glimpse of him. But whenever I'd catch someone's arm and they'd turn and look at me, when they realized it was me, they would just get back in my way. They were not going to be the one to let Zacchaeus through. They were not going to be the one to allow me to be a part of this experience. Everything I saw that day from the crowd, everything I experienced from my neighbors, made it crystal clear to me. You are not welcome here. Eventually, I just kind of gave up trying to push through the crowd. Nobody was going to let me through. And so I'm not sure if it was anger or if it was sadness or just pure desperation. Maybe some mixture of the three. But seeing the sycamore tree, I knew what I had to do. For me, a grown Jewish man, to climb up a tree in public, that was an act of humiliation. That was just something that was not done. It was akin to a grown man taking off running. You just didn't do it. It was frowned upon. It was a way of bringing shame upon yourself. But the looks of the crowd had already told me, what did I have to lose? What respect was I going to lose from the people? So I hiked my tunic up, scampered up the tree. My cheeks just burning. With shame on the one hand, but with determination on the other. And when I got a few feet in the air, I looked out. I could see him. There he was. Jesus of Nazareth. His disciples close by, the crowd ringed around them. Him at the center of the action. Jesus. I don't know what I expected exactly, but he wasn't much to look at. Looked pretty ordinary as best I could see. Just a man. No trappings of wealth, no symbol of power, nothing to indicate that this was one who could feed 5,000, that this was one who could walk on water, that this was one who could calm a storm. He just looked like a man to me. And then he stopped. He turned a little bit, and he looked me dead in the eye. Zacchaeus, he said. He took a breath. In that moment, time just sort of froze. Even as Jesus had frozen. As every eye in the crowd turned to look up at the sycamore tree. All of these, whose eyes had previously seen me with hatred, they all looked up at me. I was now the center of attention. I scanned the crowd for a moment and saw a mixture of reactions. Some of them looked at me and you could just see the secondary embarrassment on their faces. What was this fool doing up in a tree? What was he? This was shameful. What was he doing up? Some of them just looking with curiosity. Same question, different tone. What was he doing up there? And why was Jesus calling attention to this one man? But overwhelmingly, what I saw wasn't that curiosity, wasn't that embarrassment. Overwhelmingly, what I saw in the eyes of my neighbors was the glee of a mob about to form. The time had finally come for Zacchaeus. You could tell they were thinking. His time had finally come. This righteous rabbi was finally going to bring down their tormentor. Call down a curse. Embarrass them in front of everyone. Something. He was going to use the power of God at his disposal and bring him down. Couldn't bear to look at the crowd anymore, so I looked back at Jesus. This was all in a split second. Looked back at Jesus, and his were the only eyes I couldn't read. Then he said it. Zacchaeus, he begun. Hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. There it is. I must stay at your house today. Why must? That's the question. Why must? Because it seems to me that there's nothing Jesus must do. There's nothing Jesus must do. There's no one tying his hands. There's no one who can hold him back. He could have ignored me entirely if he wanted to. He could have cursed me where he stood. He could have commanded the crowd to stone me to death, and I'm sure that they would have done it. It seems to me that there's nothing Jesus must do. Jesus had options in that moment. But I'll tell you, he didn't seem to see it that way. For him, there was only one choice. I must stay at your house today. I must bind up the brokenhearted. I must welcome the lonely. I must forgive the sinner. For Jesus, love was no choice at all. It's who he was. It's who he is. This morning, you do have a choice. You do have a choice. You come here today, you've scrambled up the sycamore to get a glimpse of the Savior. But having seen him, having been invited by him, will you come down to meet him? Will you turn from who you've been to who you can be? Will you welcome him into your house? I'll tell you this. I've never been sorry I welcomed him in. Lord, thank you for the picture of a sinner saved by grace. Thank you for a living, breathing example of someone in need of redemption, in need of forgiveness. Lord, thank you that when all he saw from others was hatred, that from you he saw love. And thank you, Lord, that that love, that grace, that mercy changed him forever. Lord, may that story resonate with us today. May we each know your forgiveness. May we each know your grace. And Lord, may we welcome you in. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.